got a great squad, and like it's a real freshness at the minute. It just feels positive and vibrant, and I've enjoyed some of the previous successes, but this feels good as well, for sure. Definitely appreciate this club and the supporters, and I know there's nowhere like it. I don't need to go somewhere else to experience it. I still watch the video every now and again, people on traffic lights, and
just to make sure it was real.
Yeah.
Have you thought about what you're going to do when it goes going?
I don't really know. It's almost comical now. Even the gaffer gave me a bit. He said he'd give my wife some money if I score.
Do you worry about what you wear?
Nah, I don't. Definitely don't put time and effort into it.
Who does?
The skipper, number one, numero uno.
Same outfits twice, is that a thing?
That's the worry. I don't know how many more times the camera's coming up.
Joey G, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you.
I've been trying to get you for ages.
It's a pleasure, yeah. I was a bit hesitant, but...
It's not your favourite thing to do, is it? To be interviewed. Nah. You just like to go about things in your own way.
I'd say I'm probably more introverted in that sense. Like, I don't really enjoy the extracurricular. But it's part of it. It's part of responsibility, and you have to embrace that. But yeah, if you ask me, stay hidden away at home, I'd probably take that.
And to be fair, there's been a lot of growing up, hasn't it, since you've been at Liverpool, 9 years now. You've got a couple of kids as well, and one of the senior players in the dressing room.
Yeah, it's been surreal. It's definitely been a journey in that sense. And yeah, in comparison to when I first came, it's taken a lot of change, a lot of learning, ups and downs and so on. But yeah, I'm really appreciative of the journey. And I think to get to this point and have learned as much as I have, I wouldn't have changed anything, for sure.
You're a wide-eyed teenager. I interviewed you actually when you came to the club. You walked into Chapel Street, the club's HQ, to have your pictures taken on the roof overlooking the pier. How much do you remember about that? Because life would have changed in that couple of hours before it, wouldn't it?
Yeah. To be fair, that day is obviously a memorable one. So like that's still quite vivid for me. And yeah, I was definitely, like you say, wide-eyed. I was just in awe. It's obviously coming from Southeast London and then from Charlton and then just the scale of the whole operation. It's like walking into the unknown. So it was a bit surreal, and I didn't know what to expect. But I mean, the club is so good at that, and that's why I've seen as what it is, like such a family club. It's in those moments you get to feel like how comfortable you're made, and all the stuff off the pitch just helps massively, like getting settled and understanding where you're gonna live, the regime, the schedule, and so on. And obviously it's changed a lot since then, and staff's changed and so on, but like at that moment it definitely helped.
It's interesting that, because you hear quite a lot in professional football, like remove the excuses, put everything in their way where they can just get on with the football. But there must have been part of you as a teenager at that age where a club like Liverpool come in and think, am I ready for this? Am I ready for a big step up yet?
For sure. There's a bit of that imposter syndrome and that doubt. I mean, like, for me, I just thought, I'm an 18-year-old kid. No one's going to know who I am. In the dressing room at that point, there's always going to be big names at Liverpool, but there was some, like, for me, coming from where I grew up, I remember watching Colatori play for the Invincibles, and Phil was still here, and Skirts, and start, like, all these names, I was like, they're obviously not going to know who I am. I'm not going to expect them to, but I obviously want to show that I'm capable and like sort of get settled as quickly as possible. But yeah, it was nervy. It was definitely, and it was sort of done like midway through the summer. So then like I had the rest of the summer to sort of just anticipate it and wonder like what's going on. I'd never really been on like a big tour. We'd only like, I don't know, go up the road or something. So it was like, there was a lot of factors that come into play that probably on the surface probably people don't think about, but for me it was surreal.
How quick does it happen, from the rumours, the interest, and then actually to signing the contract? And did you have time to sort of think about it and make your mind up whether this might actually be the right thing for your career?
Yeah, I mean, for me, I guess every case is different if it's a January window or so on, but for me it was quite lucky. I had time to sort of to process it. I met Brendan at the time, who was like, obviously was really good with me, and I had like 2 weeks from sort of signing to meeting in pre-season and getting announced. So yeah, it was surreal, but yeah, a process I'll never forget. Like, the decision was easy, to be honest. Like, for me, I always had a soft spot for the club, and just getting familiar with the people, it was obviously a big decision, but one I felt like I was ready for, and I felt like it was time for me to sort of move on from Charlton, and it's an opportunity I couldn't turn down, really. It was like, yeah, if Liverpool come, then it's sort of a no-brainer.
You mentioned about the tours there. You were quite often seen walking around town, getting coffees, just, you know, a normal lad, obviously signing for a massive club. Is it then you realise how big the club is in terms of how many times on the street you stop, for example, and told we're desperate for you to be part of this upwardly mobile journey now?
Yeah, I think the tour was like, was eye-opening, like seeing people that fanatical about the squad and the team being there. I think obviously Asia's a massive supporter of the club, and going there and seeing that is something I'd never seen before. But yeah, there was a part of me that was just like, yeah, just a bit caught up in it, a bit in awe. And it wasn't like a lot for me to deal with, but it's just at that point in time, I was still like, I'd never lived by myself. I'd never paid a bill. I'd never I was just 18. I'd just turned 18. So it was like, it was just a lot to take in at that point in time. And then I came up and my now wife was still in, well, she's just starting uni. So I didn't really have that support system like on a day-to-day basis just yet. And then obviously I got injured quite early. So then there was a lot of just adaptation like taking place just on a personal level, as well as dealing with the whole move and football.
It's such an up and down career, isn't it? I think we only ever really see the smooth running from a fan's perspective when things are going particularly well. But what we don't see is the struggle. A lot of that has been struggle, hasn't it? You know, you talked about the age thing, but also the injuries too.
Yeah, 100%. I wouldn't change it. I wouldn't change any of it because it's definitely shaped me. I think in different ways, each one's been different and hit me at different periods in my life where I've had to just deal with whatever it may be. The first one was obviously memorable because when I came to the club, it was sort of like the discussion with Brendan was, I'm going to come on pre-season, see how I get on, but probably go out on loan. Yeah. And that's what I sort of expected, and it felt right because I was coming from the Championship and I was still in the 18. It was Liverpool. I didn't expect to come in and play. So anything beyond that was a bonus, really. Obviously, I was ambitious and I wasn't just going to not give it my all. But then I sort of got a few games and then got the injury. So that in itself was like a big up and down for me. Dealing with that was difficult because I'm still getting to know myself, who I am as a person. Like, my identity is football at that point, and it's to get that taken away and then have so much time. Like, I remember doing silly, like going Tesco car park and just sitting in the car park after drink. Like, I'll be in Melwood for hours. Just we had a good, like, it was a tough regime, but then afterwards I was in no rush to get home because I was going back to the empty apartment, and I just, like, you just sit there thinking. So it was just like, I'll just go about town, like you say, go to coffee shop, go to Tesco, just waste time, and then the next day and just carry on. In that first like rehab, it was tough, like definitely. But then, yeah, as time went on, like, I had some other difficult ones, and I had a big one where at that point I knew myself more. Like, I was a father and I was able to deal with it better on from the mental standpoint, but physically it was more difficult because it was quite traumatic and the way it happened. So, but like I say, I wouldn't change any of them, and I wouldn't reverse anything, go back in time. I'm thankful.
But it can be a bit lonely, can't it? When you're injured, you don't really feel part of what's happening, because what's happening is the games, isn't it? You're missing out on those.
Yeah, 100%. And that's what hit me in the first one. The second one, I'd say, I had a different perspective. I was able to look at it like from a wider lens. And like I say, I had my first son, and I had that. And obviously my wife has been amazing for me. But that one was more like worry, like, this is a difficult one. It was tricky. It wasn't as straightforward as like ACL. It was. But then, like, the staff here, I'm forever indebted to the people in the club and the physios, like half psychologist, half physio probably. And then Steve Lilly took the rehab, and it was the first time he'd done that sort of rehab. It was the first time for me, obviously. And then people along the way, like, to just help me. And then, like, Connor Mert, like, he's been a massive part of my journey. From that point, I'd say like that was sort of a new chapter in my whole outlook towards the game and my body and like how I prepare for each day. I'd say like that was a real turning point.
So many of these angels almost that float around the club that nobody really knows who they are.
100%.
But it sounds like from what you're saying there, sometimes the biggest opponent is your mind, and they can help with that to try and process it all for you.
Massively. And they are unsung heroes, really. But I think that's why it's such a good feel around the club, because within the building, like you guys would know, everyone's, I think, appreciated. See, that starts from the top, from the gaffer and how he is with everyone. That sort of domino effect carries on. And I think we as players, I think we definitely appreciate the time that they put in, but they're never seen. And I guess that's part of it, but it's down to us to sort of show them that appreciation. And yeah, it's definitely, like even psychologist Lee, like in phases, things like that were massive for me. Just trusting myself again, trusting my body. And yeah, I can't probably speak enough about how much that their help helped me, sort of thing.
Is there some fear that creeps in? You think, I'm working my way back to fitness, I get back, I'm fit, playing well. And then you think, well, how long is this going to last?
Yeah, 100%. 100%.
How do you cope with that?
I think it's just time. Like, time can be the only healer in that sense. For me, with the last one, which thankfully was a long time, like a reasonably long time ago now, and obviously I've, on a more positive note, I feel like I've learned a lot and learned how to deal with my body. But at that point, it was like, to suffer an injury where it's like you're by yourself and your body kind of like shuts down on you. Then to do that, for me, I've never really spoken in depth about what happened, and like we never really addressed it, but I was like by myself, I planted, and then it was like a big injury, a rupture, and it was like, I have to do that movement again. I need to play a pass. I need to like plant.
This is stuff you've done every single day in training and game.
Every day, and I'd done it 2 seconds before that. And then just on that one, it's like, you ask so many questions. Why did that happen? Why didn't I feel it coming? What did I do before that? All the contributing factors sort of go through your mind. So then on the return, it's sort of like the same questions. If I didn't see that one coming. But you have to just learn to be at peace with it, I think. And like appreciate the process and the fact that you do the work every day and that's all you can do. Just control those controllables, and sort of a motto I live by, I guess.
This is a good time for you, though, isn't it? Right now, you're back playing. You got rhythm into the playing. You might not be playing your ideal position, but you're playing.
Yeah.
And you kind of think, this is the big moment.
More than anything, it's just gratitude, to be honest. Like, and just appreciating it. Like, not getting caught up in just the small things. Like you say, playing every week and taking it game by game. Just enjoying that, because I keep that alternative sort of route in my mind, and like the difficult days, and we all have it. Like, I'm no like special story. All the lads have had injuries, and everyone feels like what it's like, and then the contrast of that is enjoying your football and playing every week, and I'm definitely enjoying it. We've got a great squad, and like it's a real freshness at the minute. It just feels positive and vibrant, and to be a part of that, like I say, I've enjoyed some of the previous successes, but this feels good as well, for sure.
Are you feeling the love at the moment from the fans? Often lads say at your level, at the elite level, that they regret not appreciating the good moments. This is a good moment, as Jan says, but you know, there's so much love for you in that Liverpool fan base.
Like, in all honesty, I'm probably a bit detached. Like, obviously there's obvious moments that I can't ignore. Like, if they sing, and that's a special feeling. Like, the one-to-one interactions with people in public, That's a special feeling. And the social media side of things, I guess that's the bit where I probably say I'm a bit detached. And obviously that's a big part of the game now. Like, it's a part of football. But I guess that's one bit that maybe I've probably evolved with over time. It's a massive like advantage to have, and it gives so many people a platform. But I've just found over time, for me, like, not a coping mechanism, but something that gives me more peace, is just sort of being detached and just sort of focusing on my process and not seeking validation, because that's like, it's like a roller coaster in that sense. And just having my own process where I sort of just prepare right, I perform, and then I don't really need anyone to tell me if I play poorly or not, or if I feel like I've had a decent game. You kind of know as a player, you know. Yeah, like, it's, so then like searching for it it's probably not the best solution. And that's probably advice I'd give to my younger self, like, don't get caught up in that, because in all honesty, when I come to the club, that's the first thing you do. You might be on Twitter typing your name,
You speak like a professor of emotion almost, Joe. I wonder whether that's because of what you've been through, and you've had to find ways, haven't you, to come through the other side and look at positives and keep yourself on that road.
Oh yeah, 100%. And like, I've had to adapt and learn the hard way at times and go through those things, and I'll probably evolve further. I think we all do. It's a constant, like, life's a constant lesson, isn't it? And I want to keep learning and find new ways to get the best out of myself. But yeah, I am into that and constant, like, self-improvement. So, but I definitely appreciate this club and the supporters, and I know there's nowhere like it. I don't need to go somewhere else to experience it. I think it's apparent there's not really a comparison in that sense, the support that they give us and how they are.
We've had a lot of guests on here, and they always talk about what it's like to be a Liverpool player and how difficult it is. Have you experienced that yourself? The demands when you play for such a big club?
For sure. There's obviously like an expectation and an intensity, I guess, like, to be in at the club. And you get that in interactions, and like, I've lived all over, obviously, in the time. Like, I was in the city, in Sefton, in Walton, Formby, and in interactions you get that. It's not even like, it's just like, come on, let's do it. Whatever the next game is, the derby, or like, it might be a big game, it's just like, we've got to do it. And yeah, you learn to deal with that, I guess. Like, when I first come, I was like, oh no. Oh. Like, it sort of amplifies it, and I guess you get to a point where you kind of know that's the norm and that's the expectation. You just sort of, you kind of ride the wave a bit better, I guess. But yeah, it is like, you know, it's a massive club, and it always will be. So you just have to kind of find your way, as I sort of explained, of like dealing with that and understanding the expectations and the pressures.
The manager, how's your relationship changed with him as a young kid, essentially? As Jan mentioned before, you're a senior player now. You're someone who's worn the captain's armband on loads of occasions for the club. How's your relationship changed with the manager?
In contrast, that my first conversation with him was in the doctor's office when I just got the news. But then aside from that, I'm an 18-year-old kid. It's hard in that sense to sort of be seen as a man. He's going to see me as a kid. And obviously he was unbelievable with me at that point, like, put his arm around me and said what he needed to say to me to make me feel secure and feel like I still had a journey here to have and so on. But over time, like, I'm evolving, I'm becoming a man, a father. But naturally, it's different if he signs, I don't know, Millie, an experience. Like, I know Millie, you signed under Brenda, but I say Genie. Or me at 18, like, it's being realistic, it's two different men at different points in their lives. So I'm in a good place, and I can have, that's one thing everyone knows that the gaffer's so good at. He's a good human being first, and he reads people and understands where they're at. And obviously at this point, he knows me well. There's not a lot that has to be said, really. I'd like to think I'm not high maintenance, so he doesn't really have to like put his arm around me or anything. But I know when he wants more from me, or when I can do better. And yeah, I'm really appreciative of the gaffer. I think he's taught me so many lessons in my journey, and in some points he's like a father figure, whether it's subconsciously or not. It's a male role model that's been ever present, like, for me, and he's. He's been like led by example in that sense. So overall, like, I'm incredibly thankful, because I've learned a lot from him.
Looking at it from the outside, you always get the impression, though, Klopp and Joe Gomez are okay, aren't they? I mean, you look at some other players and you think, well, maybe the time has come for them to move on or whatever, but you never get that impression with Klopp and you. It just feels like he's got 100% confidence in you.
Yeah, he knows me like, well, he probably could tell if I was a bit down or a bit low in confidence, and we'd be able to have a conversation, and I voice it, and he'd take me in, and it's always worked well. And at this point, it's like, things don't even have to be said. It's like it's apparent when he wants more from me, or if he knows I'm a bit down, or if things are good, like he doesn't need to, I don't need a pat on the back or anything. He knows I always want to give my all for him and the team, and nothing more needs to be said, really.
I think it felt like a big moment when you signed that new long-term contract, and that some people were wondering whether, is Joe going to be here that much longer? And then you sign this big, long contract. I remember just realising how happy, how buzzing you were with that whole thing. And then it was evident that this is a new phase for Joe now. He sees himself still as being a big contributing factor to Liverpool going again.
Yeah. In 8 years, never going to be playing sailing the whole time. And I've had periods where I thought, oh, is it time? I was close to going on loan a couple of times. I told Verge, like, if he'd have come in the summer, I'd have been off. the shit would have sailed, and I probably would have went on loan. And times like that, obviously, I believe everything happens for a reason. But yeah, I mean, for me to come back from my injury, to feel better physically and mentally, and to put the work in and have the guidance to be a better athlete, like on paper, in the gym, like whether that's strength, jump scores, I'm quite meticulous with that, and to get that reassurance and then to play and then earn another one and feel like, yeah, I can put that behind me, it was an important moment for me. And obviously I was mid-20s at that point, and football, as you know, like it can change quickly and you can take another path in snap of your fingers. So it was nice for me and my family to like sort of, I'd be able to get my head down and know, like, this is going to be home for a bit longer.
So how does it feel playing in this team now? I mean, compared to the great team that won the Premier League and a couple of Champions League finals and winning one of them, and compared to this one? Because the last team, the last great team, we kind of knew what they stood for. We knew the midfield three, we knew what the front three would give us. Now there's a lot more uncertainty, but almost the outcome seems to be the same. We just keep winning.
Yeah, I'd say the biggest similarity is, like, finding a way.
What does that mean?
Good question.
But you've had to do that a lot this season, haven't you?
Yeah, I think it's just that grit.
Yeah.
Like, sometimes I'm on the pitch, it's like, wow, I can't believe we won that. Like, I guess it's just not stopping. Like, you get a sense sometimes in games.
Do you sense it when you're on the pitch?
Yeah. Like, I can't say I'm got a mystic ball and I could see us scoring, but I think there's just that belief that we're going to keep going till the end. Some teams will sort of sit back and maybe sort of, but we just keep going. And Gaffer's obviously used the phrase a lot, mentality monsters. But I think in contrast, last year was a tough year, obviously. And like, we sort of lost that, not belief, but I don't think it was as apparent that we could revive a game and like have that moment. So I think that's what's happened this year a bit more. And obviously it's a long way to go, but I just think There's definitely a freshness and like you say, the previous when we won the league was like an experienced team with one of the best front threes and what a midfield and so on. It was just like ever presence, but I think now to have the change and the rotation and still consistently have that sort of nature and that belief is maybe a bit more sustainable, if anything.
How do you compare the noise then in a dressing room? Because you know, you mentioned that the successful times in the dressing room was unbelievable. When you look around now and you see some of the players that have almost come of age straight away and they're in their moment. Is it as good, if not better, than maybe it was in the past, the noise in that dressing room?
Yeah, it's different. I would say it's more vibrant, like more youthful maybe. And experiences, obviously, massive. Like, there's no denying that. But I think there's just a sense of being carefree and just, like, if you look at like Kurt, say, or Dom, Maka and Wright, lads in like early 20s that just free and like know their ability, know how good they are. That's the impression I get anyway. Yeah. They're just ready to go and want to play football. Like, that's the feeling I get. And then obviously with that, there's different banner and it's socks flying around and at times silliness, but it's just...
You need that though,
yeah, don't you? You need that. And like I say, in contrast to last year, obviously it was a tough season and yeah, stressful time. Like, that's football, it's up and downs, and you're only as good as your last result. So it was like appreciating that experience and everything that experience team done is big. But then comparing it to this year, I'd say, yeah, it's definitely just a breath of fresh air, I guess.
Jan and I were talking before you came in about fashion shaming. I was saying back in the good old days of the late 80s, would you ever be at all considered what you'd walk into training in?
No, not at all. I mean, it wasn't a thing. No, it wasn't a big deal either. And I think that's something to do with social media as well.
Yeah.
It wasn't that important, but I can guess today.
There's a thing now, isn't it?
Yeah, you'd get a bit of stick.
Yeah. I'm not an advocate, to be honest, for the camera. And before training, I put it, I said, ah.
Do you worry about what you wear?
Nah. I definitely don't put time and effort into it, like, in all honesty. But you could tell from
who
that.
Who does?
Ah.
Top three.
The skipper, number one, numero uno. he's the antagonist, I think. And
sets
then
the standard.
Yeah, and then there's some subtle underlying. But to be fair, Kurt enjoys it. He'll accept that he enjoys it, I think. The third, probably, like, he wouldn't admit it, but Trent for sure enjoys it. Like, he'd give it a good go. But it's nice. It's like, it's nice to see culture shift as well. And I think it's nice to, like, see everyone be able to express themselves a bit more and it not be, like, looked upon like it's a distraction, or because we all know, like, it's lads, as long as they put the work in and do the right things in the gym and so on, there's no need to have that sort of old school mentality. Like, they're not focused on what they need to do.
Same outfits twice, is that a thing?
That's the worry. I don't know how many more times the camera's coming up. I'll start running out, but I don't think that's happening.
No.
I don't think they're tired. I don't think two times in a row, I don't think we'll be seen. We get a heads up though.
The photographer's
there. Yeah, it's going to be there in the morning. So, boys.
Don't be caught by surprise there, do you?
Yeah. You get a message from the skip, so you get ready.
Best clubber on tomorrow, lads.
Mm.
So obviously you talk about a lot in the dressing room and banter, fashion and everything else. Yeah. But I guess also a lot of you would have become fathers, you know, having kids. And is there any sort of dad chat in the dressing room?
Yeah, 100%. It's probably one of those things that people wonder, like, what goes on in the physio room and that. But it is a big part of our lives. I think naturally in football, I don't know, subconsciously, you also have kids earlier in a way, I guess.
Yeah.
Like, for me, I was 21 and with my first, and now the second. Like, it's, I remember at the time just sort of seeking guidance as well, asking the little questions. Another one that, sorry, I missed out is Robbo. Like, Robbo is a massive figure. I'm close to Robbo, and like, I remember asking him at the time, like, he'd just had his first not too long before, and I was asking him, like, how is it, how you find it, any tips, like, what to expect. I remember speaking to Millie about it. It is big. And then as they grow up, go to school, like, some of our kids are in the same school, like, so one of mine loves Verge's little one, and it's like, yeah, they were playing, or they might play around together or whatever. You speak about those things more than football. Like, you don't really speak about training or, like, who we're playing on the weekend. People might think that, but it's more just, you want to be normal in the week and sort of just have a fresh, like, outlook on things and not be so consumed by just the game, because, like I say, we're more than just that. So yeah, it's definitely a big part of things, and that's why it's always nice. Like, the club are great at, like, bringing the families together and having days where the kids can come in and have fun and just mess around, because I think for most of us, that's probably the most important thing.
So Kenny used to put you in a hotel on a Thursday night, didn't he? So you could get a good night's sleep away from the kids.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
To be a success.
Yeah.
12 hours sleep instead of six in 2 days.
I can't knock that, to be fair.
Can we talk a little bit about the Champions League, Joe? I can remember at the time, I think it was Marbella, the training camp, and I think Bobby was struggling for fitness before the final. There was a big long gap, wasn't there? It might have been 10 days before. Yeah. And there was a game arranged for maybe giving Bobby a bit of extra time.
Yeah.
I think you maybe got the call at the time that you were going to become a dad.
Yeah.
So much going on in your life
in
that space of a week.
Yeah, it was definitely a memorable week. Like, I was sort of on standby because my missus due date had gone when we was in Marbella, so I was sort of umming and ahhing, and then she was a bit worried, so I had to fly back. I think I missed the game, the arranged game. Yeah. So I was a bit wary, like, I hope the gaffer still puts me in the squad. I obviously came back to Melwood and still trained until the day came. But yeah, I think my son was only like 2 days old or something by the time we had the parade. So yeah, for sure, it's going to go down one of the best weeks of my life. Mm. Like, no doubt about it.
I thought you looked a bit tired on that bus.
Yeah, I probably looked tired when I came on.
Lack of sleep or?
It was when I came on, you could tell I was tired, probably. Yeah, nah, it was a surreal week. But yeah, then that parade, I think all the lads speak about it. Mm. Even the last one. But that period was like, yeah, time of my life. Like, it was to be a part of that. It was being just a kid from Southeast London.
Those parades are mind-blowing, aren't they?
Yeah.
So what is your highlight? What's the absolute highlight of your time at Liverpool so far?
It's a toss-up between the two, I'd say.
Yeah.
If the Premier League had the parade and the fans.
Inside the stadium.
Yeah, that would have been the one. But then at the moment, it's probably level playing. I think just because of the parade, and that's what it's about, like being able to enjoy that moment and with the fans. And between the two.
We were both inside the stadium that day when you got the trophy, Premier League trophy. And I've never felt so sorry for a group of players, you know.
Yeah, it was...
Because it deserved so much better.
Yeah, that's the disappointing bit. But it was out of our hands, wasn't it? Like,
yeah.
I think we were just thankful we even got there, because at points when the season looked like we didn't know what was going to happen, that would have been heartbreaking. So, but yeah, I think that those two, but hopefully it's...
More to come.
Yeah, exactly. Hopefully that's the main thing.
One of my clearest memories of that parade is you on the bus.
No way. What was that doing? Oh, no,
first thing you said to me when you walked up the steps was, how long is it going to take?
Oh, wow. And I said, I was probably knackered.
I know, that's what I mean. I can remember seeing that. Nobody had any sleep, had they? But you, when I said to you 4 hours, you went, no, 4 hours from here to the city centre. And then at the end, when it finished, you said, I wish we could do that again.
It's surreal. Like, at that point, I probably was sleep deprived. It was just thinking, nah, what are we going to do for 4 hours? Like, how is that possible? As soon as it started, it was like, yeah, loving it. Like, I felt on top of the world. It was amazing. By the time we got to the city centre, it was like, I still watch the video every now and again. Like, people on traffic lights. And
just to make sure it was real.
Yeah, I'll definitely show that to my son.
Changing the lads, because you obviously didn't know what to expect. You didn't know what you were going to see, how many people were going to turn up.
It's the first time we as a group experienced something like that. So it was like, it was surreal. Like, it definitely, I remember for the rest of my life, for sure.
You mentioned Virgil before, almost in dispatches there, really, but, you know, almost gave you a second phase of life, perhaps, at Liverpool. But how big has he been on and off the field?
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously, it's apparent he's, like, a big brother to me, I think. Since he came to this point, he's been a massive part of my journey, like on and off the pitch. He's obviously going to go down, I think, in the history books, isn't he? Like, he's what he's done and his ability and how he's transcended that now to being a leader and a captain of the team is it's massive. And I'll definitely look back and reflect on having a chance to be in a team with people like Virg, people like Mo. But for me, having Virg as a centre half and learning from him constantly, like indirectly, yeah, it's been massive, and I've taken so many little nuggets and just ways of dealing with games, ways of defending from him. Yeah, and then more than anything, just getting on well with him as a person. We like some similar things and yeah, it's been nice to sort of to go through this journey with him.
Has he given any advice on trying to get that first goal?
He's definitely rooting for me. He's definitely rooting for me. Like he's, I'd half almost have to roll him to the bench to him. The way he sounds, like he's looking forward to it. But
it's coming, isn't it?
Yeah, hopefully. I've got it starts with me. Then I have to believe, don't I?
Don't you think it's helped playing left back?
Yeah,
cutting in.
I think the biggest thing is, like, Pete, I'm never really up for corners.
So Pete, that's Pete Kravitz, yeah, on set players.
Yeah. So it's like, obviously that plays a role. I'd have a little bit more of a chance maybe, but I don't know, it's weird because obviously like 8 years, it's never been that apparent, and now suddenly...
Do you get ripped for it?
Even a gaffer gave me a bit. He said he'd give my wife some money if I scored. It's worth giving it a go. That's why I'm just... Nah, I'm joking. But
have you thought about what you're going to do when it goes going?
A little bit. I don't really know. Mm. It's almost comical now. I'd almost have to play on it a bit. Like, I don't know how I can live up to the goal, but no matter what the goal is, even the lads are giving me a bit like,
stick. But it gives you a good feeling when you cut inside. And
yeah, hopefully.
You'll get one.
Hopefully. And
all players, regardless of position, started as strikers. I've got visions of a young Joe Gomez scoring loads of goals in London.
Oh, school team, couldn't stop me.
Yeah.
I was up front, literally. And then you just get pushed back. But that was sort of like the outlet, wasn't it? No pressure, just playing for the school. And I did get a few hat-tricks at the school team, that's for sure. But
I believe you.
Yeah, after that, I score in training. Get some in training, but it's just not come yet.
What do you get the feeling of? There's such a positive vibe around the place at the moment that the future could live up to even better what you've achieved already at Liverpool.
Yeah, I mean, we obviously don't want to get giddy.
Yeah.
It's a balance, isn't it, between like being optimistic and still keeping your feet on the ground. And I think previous teams, like in the club's history, and it's such a successful club, there's an expectation there. But I definitely think the formula is there to achieve this year, and being in all the competitions still is a positive start. But I think it starts with the gaffer and his belief, and he's obviously emphasised he feels that this team can do something. So nothing's done yet. It'll be disappointing if we don't take something from the start we've had, but still only halfway, really. So there's a lot to do for sure, but the main thing is having the ambition and having the sort of foundation there to build on, and that's what we've done. So yeah, it's about staying focused and being up for each game, and then what will be, I think. Mm. Yeah.
This feeling, though, did you have this from the first game, Chelsea away, or has it sort of grown into the season?
I'd be lying if I said, like, pre-season, I thought, oh, we'd be flying. We lost some big figures. Like, for me personally, like, Kendo was an ever-present, and, like, he played a big part in just my role. I think probably the most compassionate skipper there could be, I think. He's one of a kind in that sense. It was the same with the gaffer. Like, Hendo was comparable. I was 18-year-old kid. He sort of put his arm around me, but he'd give it to me on the pitch. Mm. But what a figure. And obviously Fab and so on. Millie. So, like, losing that and then the transition, it was like, wow, this is going to be different. How are we going to deal with it? How are we going to create an atmosphere that's right and new? Because we have to have a new identity. And we still have to deal with, we're going to have to deal with tough times, but we can be positive, I think, at least from this point.
There's some players from Jan's era that probably didn't matter whether they were popular or not. In fact, some of them probably took quite a lot of pride in not being popular in dressing rooms, because that was the ruthless era, I suppose. But do you think it is an important part? Because you are super popular here. Everybody loves you at Liverpool. Do you think it's an important part of a professional footballer's makeup for everybody to like them?
Yeah, I think you need balance in a dressing room for sure. I think you need some figures that are probably comfortable in themselves enough to not worry about what the perception is. I think fundamentally everyone knows it's coming from a good place, but like Millie, for instance, Millie knows I didn't always like want to hear certain things, but I always understood why he was doing it. And Millie left here and I was gutted. I think he knows that. And but at times, obviously, he didn't worry about Joe's going to think this. And likewise, like other players, he didn't worry about that. So I think there is that necessity to have certain players that don't worry about that. But then on the flip side, we've got a great, great group that there isn't any bad eggs or bad just attitudes. And I don't think it would sit well in this dressing room. I don't think it would last long, because the gaffer could read that anyway. Like, he's that in tune with the group. I think he sort of would be aware and sort of you'd have to come round if you were just doing it for the wrong reasons or being a bad egg. So it's definitely a balance, but I'd say 90%, obviously you want to be liked and get on with your peers, because at the end of the day, it's a workplace, isn't it? And you have to get on with people, the physios, the staff, and just be a good person, I think, and be respectful, have manners, be on time, and then the rest is like, you're going to be judged for your football, but if you're a good person, I guess fundamentally that's the main thing. And then the other bits who have ups and downs.
Most popular ever, who would you pick from your time at Liverpool?
I'd probably say all round. For me, it might be Genie. I just think he's just such a good person, and he'd be funny, but he's also just got a good heart, and yeah, would speak with everyone, and yeah, he's probably up there for me for sure. But there's obviously been many.
Loads, yeah.
But probably if you just like, yeah, stand out, top of my mind, Genie.
You spoke about Jordan Henderson and James Milner being able to give it to you. Who are the ones who do that today in that dressing room? Who lets them know?
Me know or the team?
Everybody.
Obviously, Virg.
Yeah.
Virg will do that. I think for me personally, I already know. Virgil could give me a bit, but he doesn't really have to in that sense. Like, he knows when I know, and I know when he wants more from me. And on the pitch, I'd like to think I'm more vocal than I was when I came. There's obviously an expectation at times. If you wear the armband, there's naturally an expectation. I don't think I'm the gaffer gives it to me, expecting me to be that type of leader always, but maybe sometimes it's more just trying to do the right things and have the right application. But obviously there's some more senior players. Like Ali is one that's always, you hear him from behind in the dressing room, you'll know about it at half time. If things aren't going our way, you'd be one to speak up about it. So, and then like there's obviously evolution, like for me and like say for Trent, I think obviously he's a massive part of this squad and what it's achieved, and he's vice captain now, and I've seen him change over time and be more of a leader. And but I'm not really one that's big on just purely the vocal aspect. I think sometimes it's application and the way, like leading by example, and they definitely will do that as well.
Some quick fire questions, Joe, before we finish, if you would. What's the harder position to play, centre back or full back?
Probably get slated if I say one, say, oh, you can't do that one. Yeah. But it's different. Like, it's different. I think the game's evolved as well. And I think, say, for instance, now when we play inverted, like with Trent inside,
do you enjoy that?
It's tricky. It's different. Like, I've had to learn about it and understand the responsibilities. But it's meant to be quick fire, sorry. But I'd say centre half is still probably, maybe because it's on my mind more, and like maybe more of an expectation on myself there rather than looking from the outside looking in. I think centre half.
People just listening to this will be able to hear how laid back Joe is. His voice just soothes you, just makes you feel calm. You can probably tell subliminally and all of that he's a well-read man. You're into reading, aren't you?
Yeah.
Any recommendations?
At the minute, I'm reading, it's called About the Law of Human Nature. It's quite...
Is it self-help stuff you're into?
Yeah, like that's all I really read. Okay. Like, probably my biggest one is a book called The Subtle Art of Not Giving a...
Yeah.
That's probably one that I sort of read at. And I think books are about timing, aren't they? They catch you at the right time and just where you are in your life. And that was one for me that sort of just helped me have a different outlook. And I'm no philosopher, but I enjoy like learning about that side of things. I think it's the most practical thing that I could apply, sort of that sort of knowledge. So I enjoy that.
We did ask Harvey Elliott when he was on if he could nominate a teammate that if he were to basically break down at the side of a road, who would he phone first? You were his pick.
Really?
Yeah. Not necessarily because you'd be able to help him, but he just thinks you'd care. You care the fact that he was in a bit of bother.
Oh, that's nice.
Who would you pick?
Probably Virg. Yeah. Probably asking to turn around. Yeah. It's always, probably Virg.
James Milner spoke about how the team would play games against each other on the bus on the way to the ground. Is there anything at the moment that you or some of the teammates compete against each other with? You play against each other on any games at the minute?
Mario Kart was big like a few months back, sort of faded a bit now, but it was, that was the one, like Mario Kart at dinner. Yeah, Millie and Hendo and those, it was tradition out like, on the way to a game, like they play Ludo, I think it's called, the Apaches. Now, now it's sort of, it's died down a little bit. It's more relaxed than that. There's no one really. But the lads sort of just, we just sit around and speak, like after dinner. It's a good sign where the food goes and everyone stays. It's more just conversation. And there are like little groups, obviously, in a way, like South Americans, obviously, like great guys. And obviously the life of the party at times. But yeah, I'd say, it was Mario Kart and now I sort of died off and faded a little bit.
If you could be a professional in another sport, what would you pick?
Probably NFL. I like watching, and the NBA to be fair, but I like the NFL. And
who's your team?
Probably LA Rams. Just because like, I watched a lot of the behind the scenes and then the year they won the Super Bowl, I was really into it. The whole infrastructure of the NFL and then the behind the scenes, I like just watching how they train.
Yeah, it's interesting that, isn't it? All the documentaries you see of them now.
Yeah.
Are they quite similar to you, the way you live your lives, for example?
I guess so. Yeah, it's probably why I like it. I don't know, but I enjoy the way they maneuver.
Let's finish with this one. Who's the greatest sport person of all time? Do you have an iconic figure you look up to?
I really look up to Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan, and I don't know. It probably just in sports in general, I guess. It's hard. Like, we've had this debate a couple of times, to be fair, like, who is the best of all time? It's hard because everyone values different sports differently and different achievements, if they're individual or team. But then there's people who are affecting the game in different ways, isn't it? Like, Colin Kaepernick, or, like, other people that have sacrificed and influenced the game in different ways and how they, put other people first, and that's different in itself, so... It's hard, I can't lie, it's hard to pick one, but I definitely just appreciate the journey that sort of those icons go on and how they transcend the game.
We appreciate you, mate. Thank you so much for spending some time with us and giving us an insight into your life away from the game as well as football. We wish you well
appreciate it,
for the rest of the season, mate.
Pleasure. Thank you very much, guys.